Hello everyone, welcome back to my YouTube channel Food Tech Geeks, where I upload videos, lectures, tutorials and various videos on food science and technology. So this video is a lecture on water and water activity. So till now in the series Fundamentals of Food Science and Technology, we have covered two lectures in which we have covered properties of food. So in this lecture, we will be talking about water and water activity. So let's start the video. So water activity is a term which will be repeatedly used again and again in the whole curriculum. So before moving to water activity, let's first discuss a little bit about water. I know each and every one of you is very well aware of what is water, what is the importance of water, and why do we need to read about the water. But yes, before moving ahead with water activity, let's first understand about water in the context of food. So each one of us are very well aware that it is the medium of cellular reactions. Now, what is the meaning of cellular reactions? We know that cell is a basic functional unit. It performs various functions in a living organism body, whether it be animal body or plant tissues. So a cell performs various functions, and for all those functions and reactions, water acts as a medium. All the various biochemical reactions going into our body and the plant body are in the medium water. So this is the main and very, very important function of water. And the second most important function of water is that it maintains the electrolyte balance of the body. We know that there are various electrolytes and various ions like sodium, potassium, and a number of ions in our body. So the water helps in maintaining the balance between all these electrolytes, and that is very, very important for a better and improved functioning of the human body. So water has also that function. So you all must have heard this, that water is a universal solvent. So when I talk about food, so various food constituents like carbohydrates, proteins, minerals, vitamins, all these are present in a form of solution, and they are solubilized in water, and hence we can say that water is a solvent for all these major food constituents. So therefore, water is very, very important with respect to food. If I talk about various examples of food, so they have a range of water present into them. For example, if I talk about fresh fruits and vegetables, so no doubt they contain highest amount of water, that is 90% of water. So fresh fruits and vegetables contain 90% of water, and the rest is fiber, vitamins and some minerals. The other example, if I talk about milk, so milk is also 87% water. Meat is also having a large amount of water, that is 60 to 75% water. And you can also see the texture of these products. As they are having a large amount of water, so they are having tenderness and juiciness in their texture. So the texture of these products which are having a large amount of water is very much different from those which are having lower amount of water. For example, if I talk about dried figs and raisins, those kishmish, their structure is very, very much different from these fresh fruits and vegetables, as the dried fruits and vegetables are having less amount of water. But yes, as they are dried, so it doesn't mean that they are not having any water into them. There is no food which is without water. Even the dried fruits and vegetables are having certain amount of water. For example, these dried figs and raisins have 20% water. And if I talk about the grains, those pulses and those grains, they are also having a certain amount of water. For example, if I talk about wheat grain, it has nearly to 12% to 14% of water. So they also contain a certain amount of water, though they are in a form of dried food. So water is very, very important constituent of all the food system, and therefore it influences its various properties. It influences its various physical as well as chemical properties. The appearance of food, the color of food, the texture, the flavor of food, all these various properties and all these various qualities of food are affected by the water. Water is having both desirable as well as undesirable changes in food. Now, how it can be possible that it is having both desirable and undesirable changes in food? Okay, I will explain these with you example. If I talk about desirable changes, so when you make tea, we will be taking the most simplest example. When you make tea, it is always, we put the tea in boiling water. And when you put the tea, the dried tea powder in the water, hot water, you must have observed the fragrance, the aroma which arises from the water. That is the desirable effect of water. As the various polyphenols which are present in tea or the coffee, when they solubilize in water, they produce the aroma, the flavor. So that is the example of desirable change which occurs in the medium water. But yes, there are undesirable effects also. The most important undesirable effect of high moisture content in food is the microbial growth. More is the water in the food, more it will be prone to microbial growth. You can take the example, if I talk about fresh fruits and vegetables, as I have stated that they are having the maximum amount of water. So you can see their shelf life. They are having the least shelf life. If I talk about milk, you can see the shelf life of milk is only hardly two or three days. That to be of pasteurized milk and the treated milk. If I talk about the fresh milk, it is having the shelf life of just few hours. Yes, there are other factors also. They are having various fats and the mineral, the food constituents which are affecting the shelf life. But yes, water is also a major component which is affecting the shelf life. On the other hand, if I talk about the dried fruits and vegetables or dried cereals, you can see the difference in the shelf life of both. So the undesirable change which occurs due to the water is microbial growth. Another very important undesirable effect of water which we cannot ignore is the loss of water soluble vitamins. Yes, about these vitamins we will be discussing in detail in food chemistry classes. But yes, here I will be just giving you a brief about this. So if I talk about vitamins, there are the classification is on the basis of their solubility. So there are two types of vitamins. One is water soluble, one is water soluble, and the other is fat soluble. So here we will be talking about only water soluble vitamins. So if I talk about water soluble vitamins, so vitamin C is the most important example of water soluble vitamins. So there is a loss of water soluble vitamins during cooking, because if and how that happens. For example, if I soak something in water and then I discard the water, so along with that discarded water there will be a loss of water soluble vitamins, and that is a very disadvantage of this thing. So that is another undesirable effect of water. So hence we can state that water is having certain desirable effects and certain undesirable effects in food, and all these will be discussed in detail when we'll be talking about various reactions of food in food chemistry and various preservative techniques. So that there you will be having a deep knowledge about all these things. So here you can see that water is having both desirable as well as undesirable changes in food. So here we have completed certain basic things about water in food. So now let's move on to a very important part of this lecture, that is what is the bound water. What are the various forms in which water is present in food? And then we will be talking about water activity. And this topic is very, very much important for the point of view of your examination. In every examination, one or two questions will be certainly asked from this topic. And from water activity, it's always been there one question in the question paper, whether it be of any entrance exam or any competitive exam. So please pay attention to this topic. So now let's discuss about bound water. What is bound water? Bound water means that water is present in the biological structure of food. We know that food is a chemical composition of various constituents. It is a chemical composition of carbohydrates, proteins, fats, minerals, fibers, gums, pectins, a lot of things. So it is a chemical composition. So it is having certain biological structure. So the water molecules are a part of this biological structure. They are bound to all these various structures. Also, we know that there are various solutes present in food. There are various sugars. There are various polysaccharides, monosaccharides present in the food. So due to these various solutes, the water is bound to these various solutes also. So therefore, we call it as bound water. But the degree of boundness of water varies. There are various degrees by which the water is bounded to various constituents of food. And based on that degree, the bound water can be divided into four categories. Type 1, type 2, type 3, and type 4. So these are four types of bound water in food. And these all are very important because it will make your base for food preservation. It will make you understand how we have to choose various preservative techniques. What are the various principles of various preservative techniques? So all those techniques are based on this concept. So this concept is very, very important, that what are the various types of bound water, how the water is differently bounded to biological structures of food. So let's understand about this. So we will be starting with type 4, and then we will go to type 3, type 2, and type 1. So if I talk about type 4, so type 4 water is that water which is in free state. Free state. That means it is not very, very much tightly bound to the chemical composition or the chemical structure of the food. It is in the free state. That means it is completely and completely available for microbial growth. Which means that microbes will attack the food and they will consume this water for their various cellular activities. As we know that microbes also perform various cellular activities, and for those they need water as a medium. So this free state water will be completely available for these microbes to grow, and hence this water will be firstly used up by the microorganisms for their growth. Hence type 4 water is that water which is freely available for microbial growth, and also we can say that it is the one with full activity. Full activity means it is fully available for microbial growth and for various enzymatic reactions, for various chemical reactions, means all the various chemical enzymatic reactions which are going in the food, it will be completely available for all those reactions. So this is the type 4 water. Now let's move on to the type 3 water. Type 3 water is that water which is physically entrapped. Means it is not chemically entrapped in the structure, but it is only physically entrapped in the matrix, in the tissue matrix. We know that in a cell there is intercellular space and intracellular space. If I talk about like the various cells are attached this way, like this way. So this space, the space inside a cell, is known as intracellular space. And the space between these two cells or the various cells, these voids, these are known as intercellular space. So this type 3 water is the water which is present in these intercellular spaces, and they are physically entrapped in the tissue matrix. So there is a difference between type 4 and type 3. They were freely available, but these type 3 waters are not freely available. But yes, they are not that completely bound to the food system, but they will be somewhat available for the microbial as well as for the enzymatic growth. But the most important for the type 3 water is that they generally take part in enzymatic and non-enzymatic reactions. This is type 3 water. And if we remove this type 3 water by various treatments, like by freezing, by dehydration. There are a number of various preservative techniques by which this water can be removed. So if we remove this water, we can reduce the amount of water, we can reduce the moisture content up to 12 to 25%. So this is the amount by which it is present in food system. Now type 2 water, bound water. So if I talk about type 2, then it will be more firmly bound as compared to type 3. This one is freely available, this one is physically entrapped, but this one is more firmly bound as compared to type 3 water. And this is responsible for various chemical reactions. All the chemical reactions like breakdown of carbohydrates, breakdown of fats and lipids, all the various chemical reactions which are taking place in the food, composition breakdown and retrogradation, and however retrogradation is not a chemical change, it is a physical change. However, various other chemical reactions which take place in food systems with due respect to time, all these are the function of type 2 bound water. And if we remove type 2 water, we can reduce or we can remove the moisture content up to 3 to 7%. Now last one is type 1 water, and it is the most firmly bound water. And the most important thing about this is you cannot completely remove type 1 water. It is very, very impossible to remove type 1 water completely. We can only partially remove type 1 water, as we cannot remove the water from the chemical structure of the food. So we can only partially remove this water. So only partially removed. And this can only be removed by a dehydration method. We cannot remove type 1 water by freezing method. Yes, there are certain freezing methods like freeze drying and all those methods which we will be discussing in preservative classes. So this water can only be removed by mechanical drying methods. They cannot be removed by freeze drying method, and also they cannot be completely removed. They can be removed only partially. And yes, but however, if you remove this water also, if you try to remove this water also, then there will be chances of oxidative rancidity, as the concentration of fat will increase as the water has been removed. So there will be very, very high chances of oxidative rancidity, and hence the quality and the texture, appearance, flavor of the food will automatically deteriorate. So that is the undesirable effect of removing type 1 water. So with this, we have completed almost everything about water which is important with respect to food. So now we are at the stage where we can now move on to water activity, and this is the most important part of this lecture. Water activity. If we go through by this name, water activity, it means the activity of water in food. It is a simple meaning we can infer by this term, water activity. And the symbol used to represent this is A, subscription mein, W. This is the symbol for water activity. Okay, so you must be having the confusion that why we are using this term water activity. Why we cannot use directly the term moisture content, water content. Why we need to use this term water activity? So just recently we have discussed that there are various types of bound water in the food. There are type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4 water which is present in food. So that is why we cannot use water and water activity as the same thing, because there not every bound water is available for microbial growth. That all the water is not playing a part in microbial growth or in chemical reactions or enzymatic reactions. So in water activity, we consider only that water which is available for microbial growth. As well as enzymatic reactions and various chemical and biochemical reactions. Therefore, we have to use this term. That water activity means all the available water or the free water available for microbial growth, enzymatic reactions, and various chemical and biochemical reactions is termed as water activity. So water activity can also be represented as vapor pressure of food with respect to vapor pressure of pure water. So what is vapor pressure? This we have discussed in previous lecture. If you have missed that lecture, you can check that link in the description box. So water activity means vapor pressure of food with respect to vapor pressure of pure water. Why we have taken here pure water? Because pure water has maximum water activity, and that is of 1. If we talk about the water activity of pure water, so we take it as 1. So it means that the water activity of food will be less than water activity of pure water. Okay, keep this thing in mind. It will help you a lot in various questions, because direct questions will be asked from this concept. So keep this in mind, that water activity of any food system will be less than the water activity of pure water. That is 1. So it means that water activity of food will always be less than 1. So this is the key rule about water activity. So if I talk about the water activity of various food system, so it depends on the moisture content. For example, if I talk about the water activity of fresh fruits and vegetables, that will be near to 0.98, or in that range it will be. So whenever we apply various preservative techniques to the food, let it be drying, freezing, irradiation, microwave heating, ultrasonication, any of the preservative technique, our main motive is to reduce the water activity. Because when we will reduce the water activity, automatically the growth of microorganisms will stop or retard. The growth of microorganism can be limited if we limit the water activity. And when I talk about water activity, I mean the freely available water for microbial growth. It means we have to minimize the freely water available to the microbial growth. And that's why we say it in a simple language, that we need to reduce water activity. So our main motive during the preservative of fruits and vegetables is to reduce the water activity. Whenever we add any of the solutes, during the pickling we add salt, and during the sugar syrup making we add the sugar. So the main motive behind that is to reduce the water activity, because the solutes will bind the freely water, and thus that water will not be available to microbial growth, as that will be bound to the solutes. So the water will not be available for the microbial growth, hence the shelf life of the food will increase. So this is the basic principle of all the preservative techniques. That is just a brief about that. So if we reduce the water activity, so what is the limit of that? We should have that idea, na? Like if we have to reduce the water activity, so we should know that by how much extent we need to reduce the water activity, by how much amount we have to remove the water so that microbial growth can be inhibited. So if we talk about the various ranges, so it depends on various microorganisms. If I talk about water activity as 0.90, if the water activity is above 0.90 or 0.9, it means it is totally suitable for microbial growth. Each and every type of microbe, be it bacteria, be it fungi, mold, yeast, any of the microorganism, they will be freely grow in the food. So if the water activity is above 0.90 or it is 0.90, it means it is purely available for microorganisms growth. So it means if we reduce the water activity from 0.90, then the bacterial growth will be inhibited. Bacteria will not be able to grow at water activity which is less than 0.90. If we further reduce the water activity, if we go at the point of water activity at the range of 0.70, it means now molds will also not be able to grow. But at this water activity, yeast will be able to grow. So if we further reduce the water activity to 0.60, it means yeast, fungi, every microorganism's growth will be inhibited. So if we reduce the water activity from 0.90 to, let's say, 0.80, if the water activity of our food system is 0.80, it's for just an example, it means at that water activity, bacteria will not be able to grow. But yes, yeast and mold can grow at that water activity. But if we further reduce and we reduce our water activity of the food to 0.60, it means not a single microorganism will be able to grow at this water activity level. So this is the main use of water activity. So everywhere, in every preservative technique, our main focus will be at the water activity. Yes, there are so many other factors also. For example, the oxygen availability, the temperature, the pH, the moisture content, and the RH, relative humidity. There are a lot a number of factors which decide the shelf life of a food, but water activity is the very most important factor in deciding the shelf life of food. And whenever we decide any preservative technique, our main and foremost focus is at the water activity. So therefore, this is very, very important topic, and a lot of questions are asked from this topic. So there is one question for you also. You try the question and let me know the answer in comment section. So this is an MCQ type question, but yes, I need that you all give a small explanation to your answer, then why you have chosen that answer. Okay, so note one, we are having two questions. So these are the two questions, both are MCQs. So answer these questions in the comment section with explanation. So the question number one says, which microorganism cannot grow at water activity below 0.90? And the options are bacteria, yeast, mold, all of the above. The second question says, the fresh food, we are talking about fresh food. Fresh food has water activity of 0.98, 0.60, 1.6 and 1.0. And here with fresh food, I mean to say fresh fruits and vegetables. Okay, I have clarified this. We are talking about fresh fruits and vegetables. So these questions are very, very easy for you if you have listened to my lecture. So let me know in the comment section and please go through the whole lecture. If there is any doubt, you can let me know in the comment section. I will try my best to clarify that. And if you like the video, please like it, share it with your classmates and friends. And please do not forget to subscribe to the channel and please stay tuned for more such content. Thank you so much.